All right, we're going to go ahead and try to start with our lunch session. So I think folks will probably be wandering in, but we'll just try to go ahead and lower the conversation level so we can all hear. So Karen is going to talk. Karen's a product manager at Quantopian, and she's going to talk about, I think, the first quantitative strategy that she wrote in Python.
First and only.
First and only.
Hi, folks. Thank you for letting me entertain you while you have lunch. This is actually a presentation, a talk that I gave at the New York meetup a couple weeks ago. So if you were there, you can focus on not spilling on your shirt. For everybody else, I hope that this will keep you entertained. I'm going to talk today about how women are conquering the S&P 500. But before I dive into that, I want to tell you about me. That's a very large picture of me, larger than life, in fact. but I'm a product manager, which means I work with developers to build software. I have built marketing software and e-commerce software and publishing software, and now I'm building software for quants. But I am not a quant, and although I have a degree in computer science, I have never programmed professionally. So when I started at Quantopian, Dan Dunn, my boss, said to me, you need to write an algo, and you need to put it on the community and share it. And this is a completely rational thing for a product manager to do. You use the software you're building, you try to understand your users, you figure out what they do every day and how you can build great software for them. I did not expect it to take me 6 months, almost to the day, to write an algorithm that I felt comfortable sharing with the community. This stuff's really hard. And so it was a great experience for me to learn, and today I'm going to share that algorithm with you and also share with you a brand new tool that we have been working on for those 6 months, the Quantopian Research Platform. It's been an alpha, and in the audience today are actually a bunch of my alpha users who have helped with the testing and building of the platform, so a big shout out to all of you and thank you. And the research platform it builds on top of the backtester for Quantopian to allow people to do kind of unstructured research into the pricing data and to the fundamental data that we have at Quantopian. It's perfect for research projects like the one I'm going to show you. And we've got about 200 people using it. And as of today, you all now have access to research as well. So when you go back home and you look at Quantopian, you'll now see the tool that I'm going to show you. So to set the premise of this algo that I started, Credit Suisse released a report, their Gender 3000 study, a couple of months ago, and it took a look at 3,000 companies across 40 countries and how they have women in their management teams and on boards and how women are represented in their companies. And as of 2013, women represent 12.9% of top management in those organizations, which is the CEO or people who directly report to the CEO, and 12.7% of boards are female. Now, last time I checked, women were 50% of the world, and so these numbers are pretty low and pretty terrible. The other thing they showed were some interesting performance charts showing that companies with no women on the board, which is the blue line, significantly underperform the companies that have at least one woman on their board, which is the gray line. And they also showed that the percentage of the management team had the same kind of results. The green line is all companies. The blue line is with 25% women in senior management, the gray is 33%, and the purple is 50%. So these are really interesting numbers for there to be so few women in these positions. Then I read the fine print on the report, and I learned that they, in order to generate these graphs, they took a look at the companies today and the female CEOs, the management team percentage, the boards, and then they just went and looked at the historical performance for those companies as of today, which means that these charts have survivorship bias in them. So if there was a female CEO of a company 4 years ago, it's not reflected here. And it also means that if a CEO was put into position 6 months before this study was done, she's getting credit for the last 6 years of performance. So these charts they're a good start. They're just not great. And so I wanted to know what would happen if you invested in female CEOs. And I wanted to take a look at this. And this was the problem that I started to discover and explore to see what it would look like. I am going to switch now into the research platform. Give me 1 second. So really quick, so you understand what you're looking at. This is the Quantopian research platform in its bare blank state. And what this is, it's an IPython notebook that we've built into Quantopian and given some data. And these IPython notebooks are built with executable Python cells. So this is a cell, and what you do is you write Python and you execute it. And so you have inputs and you have outputs. And I'm going to jump into the notebook that I've built. And I just wanted you to understand what you are looking at. So this is all executed, so you can see the code that I've written and built into a presentation to help me walk through it with you and make it easy to understand. So the first thing I had to do as a quant was get the data. The algorithm in my head was something like, identify females who have been CEOs historically, buy when they start in the position, and sell when they leave the position. And I did some Googling, and interestingly, someone asked me yesterday, they said, when you wrote this up, you said, I did a little Googling. You must have done hours to find the data. And I actually didn't. I was lying in bed one night on my phone being like, this would be interesting, can I get the data? And I found Catalyst, a nonprofit that's focused in putting women in management positions. And they had a report, and in the fine print it said, if you want the data, call us and we'll give it to you. So I shot them an email and they sent me a report that had all of the female CEOs in the Fortune 1000 historically by year. And so from that, I was able to get that list and then I had to do Google research to find the start date and the end date for all those CEOs and the ticker symbol for the companies. And that did take some time. I actually used Mechanical Turk to validate it and had some other people look through the data as well, but I got my data set and I imported it here into the platform. And so what you'll see here is the code to import it. And this is what my data set looked like when I had it and pulled it into the platform. There are 80 CEOs, and there are 74 companies represented. And so this is specifically looking at the years 2002 to 2014, the end of 2014, because that's the historical pricing data we have in our back tester. And the first thing I wanted to ask is, well, how many net new female CEOs are there a year? Is the trend heading in what I consider the right direction? And so this is just taking new CEOs and subtracting any CEOs that left the position for the last 12 years. And there is a slight upward trend. There are more female CEOs at the end of this data set than there are at the beginning. I was a little bit worried that that might mean that the market was really going to help my algorithm out because the whole market's looked great since 2008. But I continued to move forward. I then took a look at the sector weightings, because if all of the CEOs were in exactly the same sector, well, that would be a different type of analysis. And you can see that about 25% of them, so what this data comes from the Morningstar fundamentals, and so I was able to take the ticker symbols and then look up the Morningstar sector classifications for each of these companies. And there's about 25% are in consumer cyclical. And between consumer cyclical and consumer defensive, it's about 30% of the sample size. I do have some decent number of companies in industrials and technology and utilities, so it's not totally one sector, but it is worth knowing that there's a lot of consumer companies in this analysis. The next thing I had to do was scrub the data. And anybody who works with data knows that this is, I mean, you spend so much time scrubbing data. And this was actually a part where you can understand why, as a product manager, I do this. Because I went through each of these steps laboriously to figure out how we needed to scrub the data. And since then, we've changed the import function when you import a CEO. So a bunch of these things you can now just add as fields, and it does them for you. So I convert all the dates to date time objects. I then make sure any of the days of the week that are the start or end dates aren't Saturdays and Sundays. Because CEOs aren't like the rest of us. They start at the beginning of the month or the end of the month or the beginning of the quarter or the end of the quarter. It's not just the Monday that's convenient. And so a lot of them are on holidays or on weekends. And I had to take care of that data and make sure that I was starting on a trading day. I then dealt with any companies that the CEO started before 2002. So if they were CEO before 2002 and had left the position by 2002, they are not in the simulation. If they started in 1999 and were still a CEO in 2002, I buy at the beginning of my back test. So I do include them in that case. And then lastly, I learned that ticker symbols, this is something I didn't know until I came to Quantopian, they're not unique. They can get reused. So you can have a ticker symbol that's used for one company in the early part of the back test and a different company in the late part of the back test. So I have to get what's called a SID in our system, which is the security identifier. So it's the unique indicator for a company. So I go through and I do that, and this is my final data set that I'm going to work with. A whole bunch of companies with nice, consistent dates and security objects. I then took a look at the returns of the companies just to see what I was working with. And this is a quick and dirty returns calculation. I basically look at the start date, the price on the start date, the price on the end date, and calculate the percent change. But what you'll see is, let's see if I can figure this thing out. Ooh. There are some companies, these are the top five performers, with a percent change of 500%. It's pretty significant. And then there are the bottom performers with a percent change of negative 80% at the New York Times. I did at one point say, well, maybe, you know, this is interesting because the people that perform really well by a lot more than the people who don't perform well. And then I realized that no CEO is going to stay in the position if they have negative 500% returns on the stock price. So yes, there is a bottom limit to how low these can go. So that's interesting. The next thing I did was look at the company one data at a time. And the reason I did this is because as a product manager, one of my theories is that quants will want to bring in external data, get pricing data that's relevant, and then put them on a chart together. And I wanted to prove that use case and make sure I could do that use case within our system easily. So I get the pricing data, I have my CEO data, and what I do is I basically plot each company individual. This is Yahoo. And it's the close price for Yahoo for the last 12 years. And the blue indicators are when female CEOs start and when they end. And so for Yahoo, you can see the first one here, that's Carol Bartz. She was there from 2009 to 2011. And then this is Marissa Myers. She's had some nice performance. Alibaba has certainly helped there. But one of the things you can see, and this is a great place to show the flexibility, is that I could then go and put in a different SID and just run this really quickly, and now we're looking at HP. And there's Carly Fiorina, who was holding she was the CEO of HP in 2002. And so I could pretty quickly go through all of these companies and just start to see how they looked differently. And what was interesting is I realized you cannot look at 80 companies or 80 CEOs and get a sense in your head if your algo is going to be any good. Like, that was just completely unrealistic that I thought I could just manually scan these and say, okay, this is going to work. So I moved on. Then we get into the meat of my algo, the interesting stuff here. Again, just to recap, what my algo does is it takes a look at, and it runs day by day through the last 12 years, and on any day, it looks through the CEO list, and if any CEO started a job on that day, it goes and it buys, and if any CEO ended, left the position on a day, we sell that company. In order to make sure my portfolio is invested at all times, I actually take a look at the total number of companies in any period that I want to hold and then divide the portfolio evenly among them. So at the beginning of this, there are 6 female CEOs in their positions in 2002. I buy 1/6 of my portfolio in each of those companies, and then a little while later when another female CEO is hired, I basically rebalance the entire portfolio so that 1/7 of my portfolio is in each of those companies. Towards the later part of this portfolio, there are 30 different companies that I'm holding. And so then I'm holding 1/30 of my portfolio. And in this simulation, I'm just doing a portfolio of $100,000. But the rebalancing helps control things like leverage and making sure that the portfolio is investing at all time, investing everything all the time. So this algo is written here within research, but the format and the structure is the same as what you would see within the Quantopian backtester. There's an initialize function, which is run at the beginning of the backtest once. And so that's where I set my global variables and my slippage model. And then there's handle data. And this is a daily backtest. And so handle data is run once a day. And handle data is where I look at the data, find out if there are any CEOs, and then make my trading decisions. I did yesterday, because you always get a little bit ambitious right before you're going to do a presentation, I did try to modify the algorithm so that instead of just rebalancing on the days that I buy or sell, I rebalanced monthly, but I was not able to debug it well enough to show it today, but that's one of the things that I'm going to do next. And then I basically run my algo, and this is what it looks like. And as a first-time quant, I did a victory lap around the office. Like, my algo goes up and to the right, guys. Hello. I was very excited. And then I realized, yes, so does the S&P for this time period, so you actually need to compare it against something. The first iteration of this, what I presented at the meetup was, I went and I then just ran a parallel investment that invested in the S&P 500 the same amount of money at the beginning of the time period and held it. And then I learned that that doesn't take into account dividends and all of these things. And so I actually, Foss, our CEO, spent some time coding with me one evening and showed me that I could get the backtest out of our get the benchmark that we've already built and optimized out of our backtester into research. And so this backtest is investing in the S&P 500, but reinvests dividends back into the benchmark. So it's a better indicator to compare to. It's a little bit more fair. So when I did that, we end up with this pretty chart. The green line is my algorithm that invests in the women-led companies of the Fortune 1000, and the blue line is the S&P 500. So that's still pretty good. I was pleased with this. To answer the question of what the returns are, I could quickly do the calculation and find out that my algo returns about 340% over the 12-year period. The benchmark returns about 122%, so women outperform the S&P by 217%. I was pretty pleased with that. And then the next thing everybody says is, yes, well, clearly your portfolio is leveraged. Welcome to reality, Karen. But in reality, because I'm doing the reinvesting, it's not. So we hold a leverage of about 1 throughout the course of the portfolio, which is good. I'm not borrowing a ton of money to make this happen. The other thing is, well, what about volatility? Because it does look like the Fortune 1000 portfolio is more volatile than the SPY here. But running the Sharpe calculations, the Sharpe ratio of mine is 0.6, and for the S&P for the time period, it's 0.2. So that indicates that this algorithm is actually less volatile than the SPY. Now, we saw some presentations earlier, and 0.6, like, that's not a spectacular Sharpe ratio. So this is still a fairly volatile idea. However, I will tell you that for the Quantopian hedge fund, we're considering algos that are over 0.6. So I felt like at least I could submit this for the Quantopian Open, and that would be OK. And that made me feel good about it again. I'm an employee, so I'm not allowed to do that. But you know, I could. So I did want to dig into the Yahoo and Alibaba question. And we saw earlier, the scroll is not what I'm used to. Oh, it's not there anymore. We saw Yahoo, and when Marissa Meyer's there, all of a sudden Yahoo takes off, which is because of the big investment they made in Alibaba. So I can pretty easily just remove Yahoo from the investment strategy and then take another look at it and rerun the simulation. So when I do that, we still outperform, and it basically changes it from a 270% outperformance to a 214% outperformance, so it does bring it down a little bit. And the reason is because that is during the point in the algorithm when we're investing in about 20 or 30 different companies. And so at no point am I ever invested super heavily in Yahoo so that it skews the whole algorithm to be positive as a result of that. So that works out pretty well. I then also took a look at removing the outliers just to try and understand if is this one or two companies that are making the difference. And so I pull out the top three performers and the bottom three performers in order to just see how that would impact it. And again, when we rerun the simulation, the women outperforms the S&P 500. It brings it down to 196% better than the S&P, but still fairly significant outperformance there. So at this point, as a first-time quant, you know, I'm feeling pretty good about myself. And I mean, how am I the first person to think about this? And the reality is I'm not. There are two existing funds out there, the WIL, which is the Women in Leadership Fund, and the PAX Elevate Fund, both of which are focused on investing in companies that have lots of women in leadership. And so pulling in those numbers, they're different. It's hard to know exactly what they're doing. PAX has some secret sauce that they have in a black box that they basically use to evaluate companies and how they have women in leadership, and I couldn't get a lot of information about exactly what it does, but when the company has enough of a score, they invest in it. The Women in Leadership one, actually, they're very specific. It's 85 US-based companies with a market cap of 250 million, a woman CEO, or 25% female on the board. Unfortunately, they're both underperforming the SPY in this chart. The red is the S&P 500, the blue is the PAX, and the green is the WIL, the Women in Leadership. So there's clearly something different between my simulation and what they're doing there that's continuing. It's worth continuing to explore. So that's my algo, and that's my research notebook. And at this point, the question is, what do I do with this? Right? What are my next steps? And there's three ways that I've been thinking about this. The first one is academically. There is so much more that I could explore here. I could take a look, and we've already actually just yesterday got the data dump from Morningstar to take a look at this across a broader set of companies, expand beyond the Fortune 1000, take a look at it for all US equities that have had female CEOs and see what that looks like. I could do the sector analysis of this and understand how that the 33% that are in consumer companies, how that actually impacts this analysis and try to do a sector neutral version. I could try to optimize the volatility so that I have a less volatile algorithm. I could take a look at market caps and see how market cap impacts this, or percent on board or percent on management team. All of these things are further explorations that I can do here to try and find a more optimal algorithm. Those are all super interesting, and I do plan to do some of them. Professionally, I am still a product manager. I am not a quant. I am not writing this algorithm in order to get into the Quantopian hedge fund or any other hedge fund or start a hedge fund. I'm doing this to learn what my users do. And so the next step there is to take the algo, bring it into the Quantopian backtester, and live trade it. And so that's what I'm planning to do next. The key to that is actually finding the live data source. It's challenging there is no great feed, and we'll see how the Morningstar data is, but thus far I have not found the feed that will tell me on a daily basis, did any female take over the CEO position at a company? And so it's an interesting reality for me to understand that challenge as a quant. I have the strategy. My back tests look great, and I can't live trade it because I don't have the data. And so that's the next thing to try and figure out is how do I get this live data feed so that I can live trade this on the Quantopian platform and take those next steps that our users would take to try and figure out how to do that. And then aspirationally, I have big hopes and dreams for this, and they might be a little bit different than what you'd expect. Quantopian is a unique company. We are at the intersection of technology and finance, two industries that are woefully lacking in terms of female participation. And we are also have a great opportunity, or we believe we have a really exceptional opportunity, to pull together a collection of uncorrelated strategies to invest in as a hedge fund. And the reality is, in order to find the best 15 uncorrelated strategies, we need diversity. And we need diversity across a number of axes. We need diversity in terms of instruments. We have to expand beyond just US equities. We need diversity in terms of data, and we're continuing to add that. But we also need diversity in terms of the people in our community. And in one sense, we have exceptional diversity. And if you look at the winner of our Quantopian Open, or the top three people in the Quantopian Open, two of them are not professional people in the finance world. They're engineers. They do other things. And our community and the people in this room are not all people that work in the world of finance. So we are getting great diversity and opening up the world of quantitative investing to a much broader pool of people. But we do not have women. And every time we see a woman come onto the Quantopian platform or comment in the forums, we cheer. Like, as a team, we're so excited about that. And when you're here in the room or at our meetups, we're thrilled. And so what I hope for this notebook to do is inspire more women so that next year when we're all here together, the room has more women in it than it does today, and that there are more women in our community. Thank you very much. So now I'm actually going to take you one step back before I got onto my hopes and dreams and talk about that live trading step. I am not a quant. I'm not sure if that was clear to you through this presentation, but I'm not. And one of the things we've learned from watching our users is that taking that next step, opening an account at Interactive Brokers and putting $10,000 in is scary. It's really scary. And so what we want to do is give them the opportunity to take that step in a bit of a smaller step. And so today, I am pleased to introduce the team from E-Trade sitting up here. Guys, turn around and give a wave. And announce that we are integrating with E-Trade so that our users can open an account with a $500 minimum balance instead of a $10,000 minimum balance and do live trading through E-Trade. And so my colleague Sung Lee is actually going to give a quick demo of that integration for all of you and show you what's coming on the platform soon. Thank you very much.